pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker for today. Normally, we would put keynote speaker in the first session, but Dr. Chang Tai-shin of Booth School of Business from University of Chicago, he has classes this morning, he has lunch meeting, so he just arrived. So I would introduce him. He is Phyllis and Irwin Winkert, Professor of Economics at Booth School of Business, University of Chicago. He conducts research on growth and development in Asia, particularly. He has published papers in top economics journals. Those are lists included in your packet. Particularly, he has been a visiting scholar at the Federal Reserve Banks of San Francisco, New York, and Minneapolis, as well as the World Bank's Development Economic Group and the Economic Planning Agency in Japan. So he's very, very familiar with the institutional environment in China, India, Japan. He has conducted extensive research in those areas. So, and he will talk about some of the issues actually the panel touched on earlier about IP, about institutional issues, exit a market in from China or India, and those costs. So please welcome Dr. Shin, and I'm going to just try to open up his PowerPoint so he can use that. Sorry, this is frozen again.
Okay.
Yes, you can come up.
Okay.
The PowerPoint is not putting up. Oh, can you come?
Okay, shall I just start?
Yes.
Okay, great. Apologies for the technical issue. So what I want to talk about is, I want to talk about this idea that this idea of Juga. It's a Hindi term. I'm not going to explain what it is right off the bat. My hope is that somewhere in the middle of the presentation, it'll become clear to you what is it that I'm talking about. So, the general topic that I want to talk about is I want to talk about what do successful firms do, and this is going to be a general theme, a general point that I've seen in most countries in the world, and I want to illustrate how it works with one example in India, and then I want to illustrate how this has actually worked in China, because China is actually a great example because it illustrates the power of this idea that I'm going to call Jugaad. Okay, so I'm not going to explain it off the top of my head. So the question is, what do successful firms do? And the other question is, how do problems get solved? Okay, so I want to start with the case of India. If you talk with people who run businesses in India, or if you talk with any policymaker in India, one issue, one central constraint that firms face is what's called the Industrial Disputes Act. So the history of this act, this law, was basically in 1947, when India became independent. Part of what happened at the time of independence was that all of the British companies were leaving. Okay, they were packing up and leaving, and millions of people were being thrown out of work. Okay, so the response is that, you can imagine the kind of political pressures that come about when people get thrown out of work and factories close. So what they did in India was, we can understand this when we've seen what the current U.S. administration has been doing, is that you try to prevent firms from closing, right? Because you don't want people to lose their jobs. Okay. Now the problem that the Indians faced was that the vast majority of companies were small companies, and if you don't allow them to close, then they're basically just going to go bankrupt. Okay. So the compromise that they came up with is that what we're going to do is that we're going to put in place a law that basically makes it illegal for you to lay off your workers, but that's very costly, that's very costly for all firms. But then the logic was that, well, if you're a large and profitable firm, You know, that may not be what you want to do, but you can certainly afford it. So the law says that if you are a company with more than 100 workers, then the Industrial Disputes Act applies to you. If you're smaller than 100, then the Industrial Disputes Act doesn't apply to you. Okay, so that solved the problem of massive unemployment. Okay, in the same way that you know, when President Trump calls upon that company in Indiana and says, you know, if you were to relocate your plant to Mexico, I'm going to do lots of unspecified things to you. Well, you know, when you're faced with the, you know, and you, what you do is that you think about, well, how much money am I going to make if I were to relocate my plant to Mexico? What are going to be the cost to my business if I don't do this? And you say, well, you know, despite the fact that I would benefit, the costs are large and it's just not worth my while to do it, so I'm not going to do it. Okay, so that solved the immediate problem of massive unemployment. But then the question is, well, what happens in the future? Okay, what happens? So you prevent the large firms from closing down. Okay, but then if you're thinking about opening up a new plant, you're going to think really hard about it. Because they can go after you for closing a plant with more than 100 workers, but they can't go after you for closing a plant that you never opened up in the first place. Okay? So the consequences, so it works in 1947, but then you start to think about what's going to happen in 1960. So what are the dynamic consequences for your business? So if you want to think about this in the context of the current administration, you can prevent firms from relocating to Mexico, but then what's going to happen is that you're going to think really hard before you open up a new plant because of the cost that you think you are going to face. So it solves the problem now, but it creates more trouble in the future. Okay? So the consequence of this is something that that basically every single government official in India has recognized, that it basically creates incentives for companies to remain small. It's a tremendous disincentive for you to be able to grow. Because if you grow to more than 100 workers, it's basically like, you know, you go out on the first date and that's it. That's it. You have no possibility of saying, you know, I'm sorry, it doesn't, you know, we're not compatible. So the consequence of this is that, you know, the growth in India has come from very small firms. Okay, and I'll show you a little bit of data. If you are a firm with the potential to grow large, it's going to take you a lot to be able to be willing to expand your business because of how costly it is. If there, for some reason, somewhere down the line, you are going to need to draw back on the number of workers. So this is something that people have recognized for a while because it's essentially an enormous constraint on the growth of large and successful firms. So precisely the kind of firms that are going to generate the businesses, that are going to generate the jobs, that are going to generate the technologies of the future. Okay, this is one of these things that everybody recognizes is a huge constraint, but also one in which nothing ever happens. Because you can imagine the political pressures not to do anything about it. And up until now, there's been no change in the law. Okay, it's like every year we talk about it. It's sort of like, you know, I won't go into the details of, you know, this is sort of what I see around the world. I see this in the U.S. I see this everywhere in the world. Everybody recognizes what the issues are. And almost always, it's just talk. It's just like nothing in substance ever happens, okay? But what I want to talk to you about is that when you look at the data in India for roughly the last 20 or so years, it looks like the bite of this law is no longer there, despite the fact that there's no change in the law. There's been no change in the law, but what you start to see is that large firms are growing. Okay, large firms are starting to grow in India, despite the fact that there's been no bite in there. There's been no change in the law. What you start to see is that large firms appear to be less labor constrained. And I'll just show you some despite the fact that there's been no change in the law, there's been nothing done by the government, no change in the law about this law. First, I'll show you what, I'll just show you some of the evidence of the change in the bite of the change in the bite of the law, and then I'll tell you what I think is going on. Okay, so here's some piece of evidence. So this is a plot of all the firms in the industrial sector in India in 2 years, in 2000 and 2011, and it's a plot of the relationship between the productivity of labor, so think about it as profits per worker or revenues per worker as a function of the number of workers of the firm, okay? And if you think about what will the Industrial Disputes Act, what it's gonna do is that, you know, suppose that you are a large firm and you get a new order from Walmart in which you're gonna need to double your workforce to take to fully take advantage of the order. What you're gonna do is that you're not gonna fully expand to the extent that you really will want, you really will want to, because if Walmart takes away your order in the future, you're not gonna, you can't let these guys go. So what you're gonna do is that you're gonna try to squeeze the maximum amount of profitability out of every single worker that you have. So the basic pattern that you see is that profits per worker are much larger in large firms than in small firms, okay? You don't see this pattern in the US data. I'll just show you. You don't see this in the data. But what you start, so you see this positive relationship in the data, but what you see is that from 2000 to 2011, it's still there, but it's much more attenuated, okay? So the profit, so the first fact is that the profitability of a worker in large firms relative to small firms has diminished over time. That may sound like a bad thing, but I'm gonna try to argue to you that it's actually a good thing, okay? It's actually a good thing because what's driving this is that what's happened is that the large Indian firms have been expanding. So even though profitability has been falling, total profits has been rising. Okay, so this is exactly what you would expect to see if these firms were concerned. Here's another way in which you can see it. This is the distribution of firms by firm size. So the basic fact is that, you know, the typical Indian manufacturing firm has 10 workers. So it's basically the husband, the wife, and the kids and the cousins. That's essentially the typical Indian company, but this is the graph in 2 years, and you can see that there's been a small shift to the right. Okay, that's the blue dash. So it's not huge. It's not huge. After all, this is India we're talking about. Things don't move that quickly. Okay, next I'll talk about China, where things, you know, move at supersonic speeds. But this is India we're talking about, and this is a small change. So the fact is that what you see is that large firms have been growing in India, the profitability of large firms has been falling, and total profits has been rising. So this is exactly what you would expect to see if the Industrial Disputes Act was no longer on the books. Okay, that you basically, large firms now have the incentives. They're now facing better incentives to expand the business. Except that I've told you that that's not what, that there's been no change in the law. Okay, there was a question here. The average product capital, nothing has changed. No change at all. If you want, I took out that slide. I took out a slide. I don't have it here. Nothing has happened to the average product of capital. So this is strictly a change in the constraints that firms face regarding to workers, not with regard to capital. Okay? What has changed is the following. Okay? There's been a birth of a brand new industry it goes by several names. I like to call it the contract labor industry. I'll give you one example of one such company that's been at the forefront of this. I'm going to call it an informal revolution. Okay, there's a company, and I mentioned the company because I've been doing some work with this company. It's a company, Indian company called TeamLease, and the company just had an IPO. And what it does, it's founded in 1997, and the worker, and this company has 99,000 workers on its books, okay? It's one of the largest Indian companies. They have 99,000 workers on its payroll, okay? So the Industrial Disputes Act applies to them. They can't let these guys go. But what their business model is that what they do is that they supply these workers, they give them a little bit of training, and that they supply these workers to these other companies that are under the that are constrained by the Industrial Disputes Act. So when I last looked at their data, they had about 1,200 clients, mostly in the service sector. So think about the average client has 83 workers, okay? And the typical contract that they have is that there's a one-year contract, okay? And what the clients pay is basically the wage plus a 20% premium for the services of this, for the premium of this company. So they're paying, their clients are paying more for these guys. Okay, the workers are costing 20% more. But what they get is that they can send these workers back with 1 month notice. Okay, so what it gives them is the flexibility. Okay, so this gives them the flexibility. And the really fascinating thing about it is that the 99,000 workers, they can never lose their jobs. Because the Industrial Disputes Act applies to their parent parent company. But if you think about what this does, right? It basically makes this company, a team lease, it basically turns it into a labor market. Because if you think about how a well-functioning labor market should work, you know, some firms grow, other firms shrink. And we are worried about the consequences for the workers in which the firms shrink. And then the efficient thing, what we think should happen, is that the firms that expand should hire the workers that are let go by the other firms. Okay. Now we know that's a very costly process. It doesn't always happen that smoothly. And what the company like TeamLease does is that it basically provides high-powered incentives for this company to be the labor market, because once the client sends the guys back, okay, your costs are the same. You still have to pay these guys. So you have every incentive to basically find a client for these guys to start to get some revenue, to start to get some revenue. So it's a company like this, and I'll just give me a minute. So what has happened is that, so here's a plot of what you see in the data in terms of the fraction of companies with more than 100 workers that are using these contract workers. So when you look at the data in 2010, the basic fact is that 60% of large Indian firms are using contract workers. Of these companies, okay, large Indian companies that are using contract labor, 70% of their workforce are contract workers. Okay, so the way that you want to think about this, there's been no change in the law. Okay, there's been no change in the Disputes Act. What is this? What the Indians call this? Okay, they say that this is what they call jugaad. Okay, and what jugaad is basically finding loopholes in the law. Okay, there's this loophole in the law, and they basically drove a 10-ton truck through this loophole in the law. Okay, so it's a solution to the problem. It's not perfect. It's not a perfect solution. The perfect solution is to get rid of this law. Okay, but politically that's hard. We can think about many things politically that are hard, because you know the problem that the large firms face now is that 70% of the workforce don't formally answer to them, right? And so that you can't really train these guys properly. They're not loyal to you. They're loyal to somebody else. So it's not a perfect solution, but not a perfect solution by any means. But it gets you partway there, right? It gets you partway there, and it's accounted for some of the growth that we've seen in India. And I want to just stop here and just say, you know, you should think hard about this idea of jugaad, because what you see almost everywhere in the world is that the way that successful firms operate is really not by they basically find a way, typically an informal way, of solving the problems that they face. Okay, by pushing the boundaries, by pushing the boundaries, finding the loopholes, finding ways to try to navigate the institutional environment. You know, when you do business, you learn quickly the least effective thing for you to do is wail and moan. Because that never changes, never changes anything. There's a question back there. Yeah.
Just on the topic of these leasing companies' influence at the state level, 99,000 workers in an economy with 1.2 billion people, do they have any little cloud that would prevent this disputes act from being
That's a good question. I don't think they're really, I mean, this is just one company. What's happened is that there are tens of thousands of these companies. Obviously, you know, 99,000 workers in an economy of 1 billion people is small. It's small. Political clout? I don't have the sense that they have political clout, but you raise an interesting question. You raise an interesting question of, you know, that now you have one more party that has a vested interest in making sure that the Industrial Disputes Act never gets solved, because they make money. So the more dysfunctional Indian institutions are, the more money they make. If they ever were to make things better in India, this company is out of business. The CEO of this company, they're looking forward. They think it might happen, so they are trying to turn this company into an HR firm. That's sort of his model of the future. So it's a combination of HR. His other business model is turning it into, you know, this company called AEDP, this payroll processor in the U.S. That's the other model that they're trying to follow. Okay, now I want to switch to China. The story I want to tell about China is that you want to think about China as being Jugad on steroids. Okay? And I'll illustrate what I mean. It's the way that you want to think about China is taking this idea of Jugad and push it to an extreme that I don't think we've seen anywhere else in the world. And I'll start this by just starting off by stating a puzzle, okay? So one standard way of measuring the quality of the business environment is to go to this data that the International Finance Corporation of the World Bank has been putting together for the last 15 or so years. And basically what they do is that they basically get a company to try to do a number of basic business procedures in about 190 countries all over the world. You know, get a power hookup, get a phone line, register a title, get a business license, get a permission to expand your business. So a number of just basic things. I heard somebody talking about, you know, transmitting your profits back to their home country. So a lot of basic things like that. And what they do is that they just quantify this. They quantify how many steps do you have to go through, how many agencies of the government do you have to go through, how many permits do you need to get signed, how much is it going to cost you. Okay? And it's a pretty useful piece of data. It's not perfect, but it's a pretty useful piece of data. When you look at how China does in this data, okay, in the last year of the data that I believe, and I'll say why in a minute, in 2013, in terms of the ease of starting a business, China ranks 151 in the world. They're in 2013, they're 185 countries. So it's near the bottom of the world in terms of the ease of starting a business. So just so that we know 151 is, 150 is the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Okay, so you know, when you go to China, you know, you know, there's a lot of this triumphalist tone that, you know, how many years is it going to take? You know, is it going to be 10 years or 20 years that China is going to overtake the most advanced countries of the world? What this data is saying is that, you know, you're actually one behind the Congo, right? And we talk about the Congo as the place where there's ethnic cleansing. The joke that I sometimes tell my students is that, is a one way to tell whether a country is a disaster is whether it is a country where Angelina Jolie has gone to when she's thinking about whether to adopt kids. And if Angelina Jolie has gone to the country, you know that country is an unmitigated disaster. So Congo is an Angelina Jolie country. China is not. It's not. It's never. Angelina Jolie has never gone there. Maybe because of her association with Brad Pitt. That's why she's never gone there. There's an interesting backstory behind this. So when the former Prime Minister of China found out about this data, he was furious. So he tried to get this project killed. The World Bank, so there was a political compromise such that they eased up on China. So after 2013, China starts to do better, but I don't believe the data. I don't believe the data after 2013. But I want to just stress to you that, you know, first, there seems to be something wrong with this data, right? Because, you know, nobody's talking about the Congo. You know, we're not holding summits on what doing business in the Congo is like. But we are trying to understand what doing business in China is like. And if you're running a business, you may be worried about the threats coming from a Chinese business. You're never worried about a threat coming from a business in the Congo. Okay? I mean, so there's something that just seems not quite right about this. So there's something missing. But first, I want to convince you that there's something that's actually, it's telling you something real. Okay? So I just want to give you just one more piece of evidence that there's something that's quite right about this. And here's for those of you, I don't know how many of you can reach it. June can probably reach Chinese. Okay? So this is the newspaper article. So all newspapers are run by the party, by the Communist Party. So don't pay attention to the guy that's being arrested. That's an interesting part of the story too. I'll come to that later. But look at the article at the very top. And it's basically a story about, so this is an article in September of 2014. And it talks about a city in China. And it talks about what you need to do in order to get the license. If you're running a small business, what you need to do to have a small expansion of your business. Okay, and it goes on to say that, you know, I guess you can read the numbers, that what you have to do is that you have to pay 95 taxes, that's the 95 there, and you have to get 192 official chops, the official chops of approval. So this is just a small mom and pop store. So we're not talking about getting Facebook permission to operate in China. This is not what we're talking about. We're talking about a small noodle shop and the permits that you have to go through to expand your business. So this, again, I want to just stress that there's something that's both correct about this and there's something that is missing. Okay? So I want to begin to try to answer the puzzle of what is it that is missing. And perhaps the best way to do that is to just illustrate what is it that actually happens in China. Okay? So the story is, so I want to tell you what is it that happens on the ground. And this came from a visit that I made with some of my collaborators to a small city in southern China. It's a small city of about 2 million people. Okay? There are about 400 of these cities in China. If I tell you the name, you will never have heard of the city. 2 million happens to be twice the size of Boston, but just give you a sense of the breadth of China. And the reason that we went there was one of my collaborators had a former student that was a vice mayor of the education department. Okay? And I'll say more about how this particular government is organized. So the guy was responsible for running and evaluating the public schools. Okay? We went to his office around 10 o'clock in the morning. Okay? We met up with the chief of staff. And the chief of staff apologized, said that, you know, my boss, the vice mayor, is sorry, but there's some important visitors in town. He really would like to meet with you. My collaborator was his former professor at the university, and you know how the Chinese are towards their former teacher. But he'll try his best. So we sat down to talk about what his office does. Okay, so we were talking with the chief of staff of the vice mayor's office for education. And he proudly hands us this flowchart, which I translated for you, and he said, this is what my office does. Okay? This is the education department. And here's my rough translation of this flowchart. What we do, what my office does, is that we actively look for quality prospects. Then we have an initial discussion to learn about the investor. Okay? Then we undertake a feasibility analysis. Then we identify the land and other needed services. And then whatever it is they're talking about, we go to approval by the vice mayor. And then we signed the agreement. Okay, what the heck is he talking about? This is the education department. Okay, what does it sound like? Okay, what they're doing. So I'll just say that basically the first thing that you're gonna see when you go to any city in China, with possibly the exception of the largest cities. Like, it's not going to be that visible if you go to Shanghai or Beijing, but you go to any other city, basically these guys are basically running businesses. All these guys, what they're doing is that they're soliciting and they're running. But perhaps the best way to describe this is that local governments almost operate like private equity funds. I mean, that's a way to think about it. So I'll say more about the structure. In this particular local government, the number one guy is the secretary of the Communist Party. Okay, the number two guy is the mayor. Okay, some of my students who do business in China, they say how they make the mistake when they make the mistake that they go and they visit the mayor first. That's a major faux. That's a major faux pas. Don't ever do that. It's a sign of disrespect to the party secretary. The way in which you can see this is that the license plate of the car of the party secretary is one, and the license plate of the mayor is two. So you're absolutely clear on what exactly the almost took a picture. I was afraid of being arrested. But under the mayor, there were nine vice mayors. Okay, one of the vice mayors was a guy that we knew, and then we spent the rest of our week there just gathering data from the other nine the offices of the other nine vice mayor's office. There was a vice mayor. We spent a day with the vice mayor in charge of housing and population. That actually is a branch of the local government that has the largest staff, because they're the ones responsible for implementing the one child policy, which actually, you know, regardless of the ethics of it, that's actually hard work. Like trying to make sure that people only have one kid when they want to. That's a lot of work administratively. But what's interesting is that they're also doing the same thing. The leadership of that bureau, they're really not spending their time implementing the one child policy. What they're doing with their time is that they're soliciting business. Okay, they're actively, so that we went and we collected data on, and our rough count is that each one of these vice mayors, they have about 20 companies that they are in charge of. These are all private companies. So just to be clear, these are private companies, are not state-run firms that people talk about. These are private firms. Okay? And their job, their mandate, is to make sure that these 92 taxes and those 192 chops, okay, what they do is that they basically carve out special rules, jugad, okay, that these rules don't apply to you. Okay? Don't apply. So if you want, the system in this city is that there are nine vice mayors, okay? Each one has about 20, so 180 companies. Roughly, each company has about 1,000 or so workers. We didn't have access to the mayor or to the books of the mayor or to the party secretary, but it was clear from what everybody said is that the most important companies were directly handled by the party boss and by the mayor. So think about roughly as 250 companies, so the largest companies, they get everything they want, okay? Anything they want. So all the rules don't apply to you. If you're everybody else, the law. But then what happens in this? So the way that you want to think about the Chinese system is that it's basically a dual system. There's the formal system, which looks like a disaster. Okay, and if you ever try to do anything in China, you're going to really quickly realize that the formal system is a disaster. If you try to do anything to the formal system, you are dead. Okay, but what has happened in China is that my rough sense of the institutional history is that this emerged in the mid to early 1990s in China, that there's an alternative system which everybody understands very well, in which once you get into this alternative system, the roads are smooth. You get anything that you want. And I'll give you two illustrations of this, okay? The first illustration I want to say is that there's a phrase in China that people call Zhengzhou speed. Zhengzhou refers to a city in China where Foxconn, which is the company that manufactures the iPhone that's in your pocket, where that is located. So the story behind this Foxconn plant was that Foxconn first operated its plant in the interior of China in the city of Wuhan. In 2008, the next year, the governor of the province, Mr. Guo, moved to another province. It is part of this political rotation that every political leader in China goes through. Okay, I don't know what happened in the 2 years afterwards, but you see press reports in 2010 that Foxconn was the CEO of Foxconn was going to come to town, and he was going to negotiate with the local government to open up his next plant in this city. Okay, so you see the press reports on June 20th of 2010, and I found a picture on the web of what happened at the airport. Okay, so the guy, the owner of Foxconn was given the red carpet treatment at the airport. So one of these guys is the Taiwanese owner of Foxconn. The other guy is the Communist Party boss of the province. Can you tell who's who? Both are called Mr. Guo. Which one is the party boss? Which one is the billionaire businessman?
The one without the tie.
What?
Party boss has a tie.
The party boss has a tie. Okay. The party boss has a tie, and the billionaire Taiwanese businessman is the guy on the right. I would just say that what has always struck me about the party bosses, it's different. The party bosses, there are big differences between party bosses you meet in Beijing and party bosses you meet in the local governments. The guys you meet in the local governments, I've found them to be the most ambitious people, the most ambitious people. And also, in terms of their personality, they really remind me a lot of my Booth MBA students, that they're primarily pragmatic deal makers. They're mostly pragmatic deal makers. They want to make deals happen. It's the guys in Beijing I found to be a royal pain in the you-know-what. And you can also see this in terms of the leadership in China. Like the people in the Politburo Standing Committee in China, they've almost always come from serving stints in the local government. They never come up through serving stints in the Chinese central government. If you look at the history of President Xi, for example, I mean, he basically made his reputation from serving, basically doing this type of thing, okay? So what they mean by Zheng Zhou speed is that, you know, press reports that he came to town on June 20th of 2010, okay? There were more press reports that they signed the agreement on June 29th of 2010, okay? I saw the formal agreement, and the formal agreement was that the city of Zheng Zhou was to expand a runway at the airport so that the FedEx planes could come with ease. They were to build what they call the social infrastructure. So the local government was responsible for building the dorms for 200,000 people. That's a lot of dorms. 200,000 workers. They built the hospitals. If you have 200,000 workers, lots of these guys get sick. So you need lots of health. You need lots of health facilities. And in August of 2010, 2 months, okay? In 2 months, a plant employing 200,000 workers opened up for business. Okay, 2 months. Okay, it took 2 months to go from zero to 200,000, and then the next month, stuff was rolling off the FedEx planes into your pockets. Okay, this is what what you get when you are in this alternative system, okay? When you're in this alternative system. So let me give you one more example of how this plays out in practice and how it helps you understand the kinds of things that you see. And it helps you to think about, you know, what are the benefits and what are the costs of this. And it gives you some guidelines of what are the things you may hear. I have some, this is a picture outside the Foxconn plant. It's a sign that says this road is only to be used by Foxconn. The way that you want to think about this is basically turning these local governments into something like a private equity fund, okay? But it's not just a private equity fund, but it's also a private equity fund with the control over all the police, control over the judges, control over the media. So it's turning all of the levers of essentially a Stalinist state to the support of profits of a private business, okay? And that's what you see. So let me just spend, do I have five more? Okay. Let me give you the story of the development of the car industry in China. And I think it's a nice illustration of how all these forces play out, okay? The largest car company in China, sells the largest number of cars, the most profitable company, is this company called Shanghai GM. Okay, it's 50% owned by General Motors, Okay, it's and 50% owned by this other company called SAIC, the Shanghai Automobile Industrial Corporation. Okay, the SAIC Motor Corporation, it's a publicly traded firm, so you know your 401k may own shares of this company, but the majority stake is held by the local government of the city of Shanghai. Okay. That's important to keep in mind. This is a company that's owned by the Shanghai local government, not by another city, not by the central government, but by the Shanghai local government. So if you think a little bit about the structure, right? That basically Shanghai GM is a joint venture between Shanghai, the Shanghai local government, and GM, okay? I've heard some Chinese make jokes after 2008 when GM was bailed out by the US Treasury, that GM is a joint venture between the US Treasury and the Chinese Communist Party. But sort of for a time it was. But it's been an enormously successful venture. So GM last year sold 3 million cars in China with enormous markups, and I'll illustrate. Worldwide, China contributes 70% of the profits of GM worldwide. So a hugely successful venture for GM. Now let's dig a little bit into this company, okay? The department, okay? The Shanghai Automobile Corporation. It also owns 50% of another joint venture, which is Shanghai Volkswagen, which is the second largest car company in China. Is somebody here from Shanghai? Let me know. Has anybody been from Shanghai? Okay, what are the taxis you see on the streets of Shanghai? What?
The foreign-owned company, the taxi is same as the state-owned company, 25%.
No.
Taxi cabs.
So he said it. Okay, there's only one type of taxi that you're going to see in the city of Shanghai, which is an old, ratty 1980s model, the Volkswagen Santana. I don't know whether you ever wondered why that was a taxi. Well, this is the reason why, right? That basically the same body that licenses the taxis is also the same company that owns the company. So if you want to open up a taxi company, you have a choice as long as you buy one car. Because if you buy any other type of car, there are these 300 rules that you have to go through in order to get your, so they're going to pull a Uber on you. Like, they're going to say, oh, there are all these rules that you are going to have to follow. But if you buy a Volkswagen car, things are easy. Things are smooth. Somebody from Beijing? Has anybody here been to Beijing?
Yes.
You must have been to Beijing. Okay. Did you ever notice taxis in Beijing?
So far, the Hyundai.
They're all Hyundais. Yes. Okay. You are not going to see a single Volkswagen as a taxi. Now, why only Hyundais?
They have an agreement, same type.
It's a similar deal, right? It's a similar deal, but the company that makes the Hyundai is the joint venture between Hyundai and the Beijing Automobile company. Okay, so the way maybe you want to think about it is it's basically right that each government basically tries to make money, okay, and they're ferociously competing with each other. So the Beijing local government, they hate the Shanghai local government with as much intensity as any yes, there was a hand up there.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Now, what you said is that the local government's right. These are institutions that they control,
yeah,
right, to support some business ventures, right? How do they navigate regulations that come from Beijing, from the federal government?
Okay.
Could those stifle?
Okay. How do they get let me ask you the question, okay? So that's an interesting question about how the political system works, okay? Did you ever look at the Constitution, like who are members of the Chinese Politburo?
Right.
You never look at the Politburo. So think about, say, like who is in the Chinese Politburo? If you think about two people, the Minister of Finance of China, or the Communist Party Secretary of Shanghai. Okay, there are some people from China here. Okay, so who has a higher political status? Who is always in the Politburo? Who is never in the Politburo? So what you're always going to find is that the Party Secretary of Shanghai is always going to be in the Politburo. The Minister of Finance is never been in the Politburo. So the way the political system works is that all of the substantive power is in these powerful local governments. Okay, it's really a big misunderstanding. You go to Beijing, that's not where the power is. Okay, it's not where the power. The power is in the hands of these powerful local governments. You can also see this in terms of who gets promoted. I'll give you one example. About 12 years ago, the governor of the Central Bank of China, okay, it's a guy called Mr. Dai, okay, he was moved to becoming the vice mayor of the city of Tianjin. And everybody congratulated him because it was a huge promotion. It was viewed as a huge promotion. It's almost like, you know, Ben Bernanke steps down from being the Fed chair, and then he goes on to become the vice mayor of Baltimore. Everybody say, oh my God, great. Now you finally arrived in life. But that's the way that the system works, right? The power is really in the hands of these local governments. So the answer is that sometimes they do what the central government wants, but whenever things matter, okay, they can basically pull rank over whatever, because they are the central government. Okay? Or it's not that they are in a central government, but they are in the organs of the party that control the central government. That's really there. So that helps you understand lots of things, like, you know, why it's really hard to deal with the environment, why it's really hard, you know, like in the last 7 years, they've been dealing with the buildup of local government debt. The Minister of Finance has been wailing about this, but, you know, when it comes push to shove, you know, they have no power relative to these guys. Let me just say one last thing about the Shanghai Automobile Corporation. They also run a third company, okay, which is called SAIC, in which they try to sell cars under their own brand. Okay, so think about this big company, SAIC. They have three main things: Shanghai GM, Shanghai Volkswagen, and its own standalone car company. There's a really fascinating story about how GM first entered into China, and it entered into a joint venture with a local government in a small city in northern China. And then they realized that small city in northern China, they couldn't give them what they wanted. So they knew, after understanding the system, they decided that to succeed in China, they have to go into business with the party boss of the city of Shanghai. And there's a fascinating story about how they went about it, but they finally got it. Okay, and the reason they went in, if you think about what was it that Shanghai gave them, it's a very different calculus from what say an automobile manufacturer in the U.S. would do, right? In the U.S., you look at where the supply chain is, you look at where are the lowest costs, where the easiest transportation network. That's not the calculus in China. Okay, what you get is that the reason they wanted to go into Shanghai is because they wanted the protection of the party secretary of Shanghai, that such that they would be given the monopoly rights to sell certain type of cars in the city of Shanghai. Okay, so the explicit agreement they had with the city was that the city would essentially give them the exclusive rights to sell family size sedans in China. So so for GM, that's great. For us, but for Chinese consumers, you know, that sucks. It's a terrible thing, because you want to buy a Honda, good luck. You want to buy a Toyota, good luck. There's nothing that says that you can't, but, you know, Honda and Toyota, you have to jump through all these hoops, and they basically don't try, okay? So they wanted something from the local government of Shanghai, but now think about what are the dangers that they face. Again, think of this, you know, before you start to think that Jugaad is such a wonderful thing. Okay, if you're running GM, okay, and you're thinking about going into business with the party boss, maybe the best way to think about this is that it's like doing business with the mafia, right? It's like doing business with the mafia. So the mafia is great. You know, I don't know whether, you know, I just saw the movie Godfather with my kids. The most striking thing about the Godfather is just the difference between insiders and outsiders. If you are on, what's the name of the main guy? Michaels. You guys must know the story.
Don Corleone.
Yeah, Don Corleone. If you're on Don Corleone's side, things are golden. Okay, unless you try to cheat him. Right? If you're outside, then God save you. Okay. So once you're on the inside, but now if you're running GM, what might you be worried about? What does your business partner want from you? Mm-hmm. Why do they want you in? They want the profits. Okay, they're 50% of the profits. What else does your business partner want? They want technology. What else are they doing? Okay, they're basically what you know full well. If you have half a brain, you know that the reason they want you in is because they make crap for cars. Okay, and they want to learn how to make cars. So they want you in, and what they do is that they rotate they place their managers and their engineers into the joint venture. After a couple of years, they move back into the parent company, and you think they're going to forget everything that they learned? You think they're going to forget everything? So you know that's what's going to happen, right? So, and you think, well, what if they steal my intellectual property? What can I do? What can you do if Don Corleone steals your intellectual property?
Thank him.
What?
Thank him. Say thank you.
Say thank you. I mean, you don't want it to happen. If somebody steals your partner steals your intellectual property, say in the U.S., okay, you have a legal agreement. You go to a court and you try to enforce the agreement. You go to a court in Shanghai. Who's going to be in control of the courts? Yeah. Right? It's the party boss. The party boss, and the party boss appoints the CEO of SAIC, appoints the judges, appoints everyone. So you know that it's hopeless. Okay, so what do? You want the money, right? You want the profits of that it comes from being in business with Don Corleone, but you're terrified of what Don Corleone can do to you. And here it's explicit. Okay, they want to eventually make cars on their own. They eventually don't want you there. Okay, so GM's solution was okay. The solution that GM came up with. Was that okay? We know that our partner is gonna want to take our intellectual property. What we're gonna do is that we're only gonna sell cars in China that if our partner were to ever steal our intellectual property, nobody else in their sane mind would ever buy this car. So what they did is that their first car they sold into China was this old bottle, the Buick New Century, introduced in 2001, gone out of production in the US 10 years earlier. Retailed for $44,000in Shanghai. So this is the cost of this. Okay, if you just give me 1 more minute, I'll tell you the really interesting twist to the story. For GM, this was working out great because they were basically selling cars that nobody else wanted to buy, but they could sell it in Shanghai because they had the support of the boss. Okay, their strategy started to come apart. When they tried to introduce a car that was slightly smaller, so they took a design from their Korean subsidiary Daewoo, okay, and they tried to introduce that car into China. And what they found out 6 months before they're ready to sell the car, that another Chinese company had come onto their market with exactly the same car, okay. Okay, so it's a GM issue. So somebody had stolen Shanghai GM's intellectual property. And it's this company called, here, there's another car. It's a company called Chery. Okay, so I have a picture of the GM car, a picture of the Chery car. Okay, so the Chery car is a car that's green. It has a half smile on the right. The GM car is a knockoff of the Korean car. So when you talk with the GM engineers, they will say they were shocked by this. They talk with their Chinese counterparts. Do you know anything about this? No. We don't know anything about this. They bought the car. You couldn't buy it in Shanghai at the time, so they went to this other city to buy it at the time, and they realized that they were working from exactly the same blueprints. So somebody was despite what I just told you about how the Shanghai party boss is powerful, somebody is daring to cross this, guy. What is this company? Just give me 30 more seconds, I'll say more. It's this company called Chery, okay? Which is a fascinating company, okay? So this is officially a state-owned company, okay? It's officially a state-owned firm. And it got started by these two guys. It got started by this guy called Mr. Yin, who was still the CEO of the company, and by this guy called Mr. Zhan, who was the vice mayor of the city. Okay, Wuhu is a small, poor city, okay, that is the most unlikely place in the world to ever start up a car company. Okay, but there's a long and interesting story behind this. Okay, but the main problem that they had for a very long time was that they could not, they were not allowed to make cars. Again, this goes back to what I said 20 minutes ago. Part of the crazy rules and regulations is that at the time, only six companies in China were allowed to make cars. Okay, Shanghai, SAIC was one of the company. Beijing was another one. Guangzhou was another one. So they entered into a deal to make a car. They went to the central government. This was not a particularly powerful local government. So they tried to get license to make a car, but they couldn't. Okay, so they hit upon the following strategy. They said, okay, fine, we can't get a license to make a car. They said, what about if you give us a license to make a car engine? Okay, so they went and got a license to make a car engine. They went to, they found an old Ford engine plant in the UK. They disassembled the old Ford plant, took it back to China, started to make engines. They went back to the central government and said, you know, we have a great company, we have a great product, but we need some cars to put our engines, engine into, or else we're not gonna, our workers aren't gonna have a job. So, but we know we're not allowed to make cars, so what about you give us the following deal? You know, you give us a license, a partial license to make a car, and we promise that we'll only sell a car in our city of 1.5 million people. So politically, that worked, right? If you think about, now you understand the system. So the guys at GM, the guys in Shanghai said, fine. You know, we don't care about the city. As long as you don't threaten our markets, it's fine. So they got that limited license. They went and they found an old Volkswagen plant outside of Barcelona. They disassembled the plant outside of Barcelona, took it back to China. And the first car they made was a clone of the Volkswagen Jetta. Okay. Then they went back to the central government, and they could only sell their cars in the city. So they forced all the 500 taxi drivers to buy the car. That doesn't work. You know, it's a high fixed cost business. They were running out of money. The company was basically dying. Okay. They hit upon the following scheme. The vice mayor went to his political patron in the central that was high up in the party, and begging for help. And the patron came up with the following scheme. Why don't we go to SAIC and give them the following deal? So they went to SAIC and the partner of GM, and they offered the following deal. They said, you know, there's this great new company, and you know, they will make a great joint venture partner with you, and we'll give you a great price. We'll give you 20% of the equity of the company, and you pay nothing. So SAIC took the deal. Cherry, this company, they got a new registration. They went with the new registration. They went back to the central government and they said, look, you know, we're not allowed to make cars, but the six companies are allowed to make cars. Look at our new registration. 20% of us we're owned by SAIC. We are SAIC. You know, we are one and the same. So that got them the full license to make a car. 3 years later, they basically bought that 20% equity share back, and the second car they made was a clone of the GM car. So the GM engineers would say they were shocked first that somebody had stolen their property, their intellectual property, and second that this company was jointly owned by their partner, I think the story is, but here's the interesting nuance here, the picture of these two guys. So this is the CEO of Cherry. He's now bought up Jaguar. It's been a hugely successful company. But here's an interesting thing about the company. Cherry is the largest exporter of cars from China. 40% of its sales comes from, it doesn't sell to the US because that's not what the market is. Shanghai GM sells nothing. Because if you think about, you know, it doesn't have to sell anything because it's already making enormous profits from the market. So I'll end by just giving you one picture. A few months ago, I was in a small town in Colombia, and the cars you see in the streets of Colombia were basically the Korean cars and the Cherry cars. Here's a picture of a Cherry car in the city of Villavicencio in Colombia. So this is a a house, in, a car in front of a baker's house, and this is what he used for his business. And you see, you know, and Chery has about 20% of the Colombian market. And my claim is that it's been the fact that there have been, you know, hundreds of thousands of companies like Chery that have been responsible for what we've seen coming out of China. That's been, you know, these are the companies that are threatening U.S. firms. And it's been, you know, everybody understands that the way that you operate in the system is by navigating it in the same way that Chery has. Okay, I'll end here and happy to take questions.
Any questions? Dr. Shin will probably stay after afterwards for a little bit if you have, you know, you want to ask questions individually, but I realize that we're 5 minutes past the end time, so Dr. Green will give a brief closing remarks, and then thank you very much for joining us.
Okay. Just in closing, just a couple of items. In your folders, there is a paper that says seminar evaluation form. So if you would please take that out, and we would really appreciate it if you could take the time to fill out the seminar evaluation form. I believe you could just leave that on your table or give it to one of us as well. We will also be sending out a link to our website once the videos and the other presentation materials are posted. On our Doing Business and website, we also have materials and resources from our previous seminars, including Doing Business in Latin America and Doing Business in Africa. And finally, I'd like to thank our sponsors and our panelists and organizers and our keynote speaker today. So let's give everyone a round of applause, and we look forward to seeing you here next year for our next Doing Business in seminar. Thank you.